Isn't God good?
All the time.
All the time. Look at that. The best is yet to come. That's God, not us. The best is yet to come. That's what he always says. If you look in his book, no matter how bad things are around you, the best is still yet to come. And the greatest one that's yet to come is we're going to be with Jesus before long. Isn't that cool?
Amen.
All right, give him our hands out of praise. Everybody stand up. Well, come on, you can do better. Give him a hand clap. There you go. Is all the time. Remember, we do our prayer for Israel. You don't need to stop that. Not now. Psalm 17:7-9. Y'all say this with me. Show how wonderful is your grace, Savior of those who seek at your right hand, refuge for their foes. Protect them like the pupil of your eye. Hide them in the shadow of your wings from the wicked who are selling them, from the deadly enemies who are all around them. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I love this too. The church is not an audience to be entertained. It is an army to be trained and empowered. Get ready to say this together. Repeat this. These are the two most important hours of my week. Help me to cherish them. I'm here today to worship, not to be entertained. I'm seeing to an audience of one accept my worship, oh Lord. Ain't God good? I know I favor the guy only up here. But he's busy with a train derailment and busy with a car in Jack's Creek and all kinds of things. And he said, Daddy, I said, say no more. I got this. You take care of all that. Amen. So, God's good.
Yeah.
All the time. Look what the Lord has done. Y'all ready to worship a little bit? Look at smile. Look. Do this. Yeah, before you get ready to throw baseball, before you get ready to play basketball, you kind of get ready. Y'all go ahead. Everybody do this. Get ready. Everybody get ready. We're going to worship God today. Y'all all ready? Says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates The floodgate, that's powerful, of heaven to pour out so much blessings that there will not be room enough to store it. And yes, here it is. Here we go. Taking it slower there. Come on. There it is. Y'all get your offering. If you've already put it in the back, that's okay. If you haven't put it in the back, hold it up. Anybody put that hand up. Let's say this together. I lift my offering to you. Let it please you, O Lord. This is my seed. Oh, it leaves my hand, it will never leave my life. You will multiply it. Accept my seed. Oh, Lord, give Lord a hand clap and pray.
Lord, prayer at this time. Does anybody have an outspoken request this morning? I'd like to remember the family and friends of Jamie and Douglas who passed away unexpectedly this past weekend, only 24 years old. Anyone else? Uplifted hands, special needs, lost loved ones. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Oh, we thank you for the time and opportunity it is to be in your house and to be amongst thy people.
Yes.
We have joined together in one mind and one accord. We ask that your presence would show itself strong in this place this morning, Lord, and touch each and every heart and every life. You see the hands, you know the needs, you heard the request, Lord God. We just ask you to show yourself strong in each and every life. Let your people see it that they may truly believe and depend upon you in all things. And give testimony for what you have done, Lord God. We'll thank you for everything that's said this morning. Now be with us. Prepare our hearts to receive, Lord God, the word that you have for us this morning. And anoint the pastors he delivers. And we'll be sure to give you honor, praise, and glory for it all. In Christ Jesus' name, the church did.
Amen. Y'all stand back up. a surrendered heart, it's all about us. With an unsurrendered heart, it's all about us. But with a surrendered heart, it's all about Him. We did Mark's funeral yesterday, and Mark told me specifically, sitting down in that room with him a few months ago, he said, "When you do my funeral, here's how it's going to go. I want my stepson, and I want a co-worker, and I want you to finish it." And he said, "I want all y'all to talk about it. I want the music, I want anything. I want all y'all just to talk about Jesus." When it come about time, I said, "I'll tell you what, I heard him, and I told him I'd make sure I talk about Jesus. I said, but I didn't tell him I want to talk about Him." And I saw that moving there 10,000 years, and I was thinking about, can you imagine? He seen his mama and his daddy without them being 90-something years old and old and frail. And he's the only one got that fibrosis in his lungs and that cancer. And it's amazing, amazing, amazing what has happened. And the biggest thing I said, the scripture I want to use for him is, honor thy father and thy mother. It's two times in the Old Testament, six times in the New Testament, which means it's very powerful. God really puts a lot of value in that. And this guy taught it from time to time, but he lived it very loudly. He took care of some really sick parents. And I can see now all the reward he's getting with being with his mama and his dad and everybody here. Isn't that cool? I hate to leave him here, but I thank him because he had a surrendered heart. It's how somebody, God act with me, and I'm going to please Him and praise God. He's there now, and He's finding that. It's really, really awesome. Let's go do this. Ready?
Thank you.
Our guys are looking good today. I know you can't help it.
Again, y'all need much prayer because I'm doing a funeral for a 25-year-old today. Mark, it was more of a celebration because he had a life well lived. Today, it's a life cut short. And that just does something to my heart. And let's make sure that, you know, just pray for that family, because I was with that family and was like, God, we need God to do something special. We trust God to do that. Now, get your Bible out. Again, he turns to the table of contents. And he turns to the table of contents, find the book of Micah. We're almost through. Next week is our last week on this, because we're going one at a time. Book of Micah, stand for the reading of the word, and get your table of contents out if you can't find it. And get to it, and let's see what God's got in store for us. Micah chapter 6, verse 8, one verse. And we're going to talk about this verse a lot. He has shown thee, O man, what is good. I've already shown it to you. You don't have to beat us up. God doesn't have to beat you up. I don't have to follow behind you and beat you in the Bible. Your wife doesn't have to beat you. You don't have to beat your wife and children in the Bible. God, not only these servants, he's put it. Yeah. You feel it, you know it. He has shown thee, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of thee. This is what God does require of the preacher, the deacons, the clerk. He requires this of every Christian. Don't say everybody.
Everybody.
That's why I say anything you have. But the New Testament, we talked about last week, to love mercy. Y'all say love mercy.
Love mercy.
And to walk humbly with thy God. God's got this. Let's pray. Father, I love you. I praise your name. I thank you, God, for your grace. I thank you for your mercy. I know, God, that you are alive and well and on the throne. I thank you, God, for what you've done for us and what you're doing through us. Ask you right now to help us, God, to know the reclusion of what you require of us. Ask you right now to touch in a very powerful way. We thank you for it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. The church said,
amen.
Amen, amen, amen. All right, you can be seated. On the way down, tell somebody, if you're not here after a lecture, you'll be here after I'm gone. Let it in. But that was very good. You said it with me. Oh, okay. Thank you, Doug. I feel better now. Yeah, I pulled up to the detention center and I'm driving Luna's vehicle right now. And on the back, she's got warning in case of rapture. Just call me in there. It's amazing because when I pull up to a stoplight, every time I pull up a stoplight in Greenville, cell phone's going up. And I said, Luna, it's good advertising. If people keep thinking, I pulled up one place, I said, man, Luna, come and stop with you. She got said, I like your car. I said, yeah, I like these sides, not the knee sides, the window. I said, the rapture place. She said, yes. I said, I like to do this rapture place. I'm still driving. I'm not going to lock it in. Every time this little boy went over to his buddy's house, a little bit ago, every time he went to his buddy's house, he found his friend's grandmother deeply engrossed in her Bible. Finally, his curiosity got the best of him. He said, why do you suppose your grandmother reads the Bible so much? I'm not sure, said the grandma, I think she's cramming for finals. Yeah, you know what? Jesus is getting ready to come back, so we cram for finals right now. Isn't that cool? There we go. The Gospel of Micah, 6 and 8. What does God require and expect from us? Mindset on the offense. Not the mindset that's a fish, but the mindset on offense. That Texas front quarterback that might have been a chance to play while it being bad to the bone. I can't think of his name right now. Some of y'all might know it, but he won one of the championships, and he got up on the television and said, first of all, I want to thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Then I want to thank my teammates because it worked to speak with everybody. And NBC cut out for it about, I want to thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You can watch it. You can see it. They cut it out. So that's how he won the offensive player of the year. And I watched it this morning just to see what he said. And the very first thing he said was, he held up the trophy and says, I want to thank my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And people started clapping because I know what happened to him. NBC gave to him. They started clapping when he said that. So, he's making a difference in all kinds of ways for God. We can make that same kind of difference, although we might not be a professional ball player. Some may never be a professional ball player. I'm one of them. But we can still make a difference in people's lives. So, let's look at this. The Gospel of Micah. Let's go ahead and read this. We'll go on since. He has shown you, old man, what is good, and what the Lord does require of you, but do justly. This is the New King James Version. But do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. Now this here is the New Century Version. The Lord has told you what is good. He has told you what he wants from you to do what is right to other people. Love. What's that love?
Love.
Love being kind to other people. Others. Live humbly. Obey your God. And then one more. The message. But he's already made it plain how to live and what to do. What God is looking for in men and women is quite simple. Do what is fair and just to your neighbor. Be compassionate and loyal in your love. And don't take yourself too seriously. Take God seriously. So let's just go a little bit further here. This whole year we've been talking about realigning our vision. Getting back in there, because since 2020, it's been all over the place. And right now it's election season. And it's because it's election season. Whoa. Every day before election, every day the headlines are changing. But now, whoa. It's so amazing. What's going on? A lot of people are speculating and what's going to happen, blah, 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 blah. And you're not careful, all this clutter is going to clutter up your spiritual mind. And you get so worn out and get so cluttered in your mind that you can't do what God required you to do. So to realign our vision, the message is a program called action. It's a divine mandate. God is telling us what he requires of us again, to act justly, love mercy, and all comfort. And God can't say it enough. This is called it challenges us. It examines our hearts. It checks out our actions. And it calls us to align our lives with the will of God. So this is so powerful. One little bitty verse. That's why I call it the Gospel of Micah. That one little bitty verse is so profound. And if you couldn't think of any of the verses you want to live with, that one right there is a very, very powerful one. Because it contains 3 points, and each point can stand by itself. Because it is an essential pillar to the Christian walk. It's vital that we learn this, that we get in our spirit, and we understand God wants us to replicate him. God wants us to do not only others, do unto others as you can do unto you, but at the same time, look kind of in the middle of this thing. So, in the very beginning, we talked about this mindset, and the mindset being led by faith. And then the last week, we talked about the offensive mindset being led by agape love, the love of God. And so, if you take the love of God, the supernatural love, and you take advantage of the supernatural power of God, then it builds an unstoppable mindset. So let's just go a little bit further here.
Again, this is New Testament version. Ready? Christian Standard Bible says, "Teacher, which command in the law is the greatest?" He said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind." This is the greatest and most important command. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets depend on these two commands. I thought about that. How would you like to be in the championship game? It's the last play of the game, and you intercept the football. Y'all are down by just a couple of points, but you see the goal line. And you get run with all your heart because you know you can win that championship if you get over that goal. And this really happens. And you notice that you're outrunning everybody. And you find out when you get across the goal line that you got disoriented and run across the wrong goal line and gave up the game. That can happen to us. If we're following all this stuff God says to do, but we refuse, we don't understand, we don't get it. Love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. The Empire Bible says, "Teacher, what's the greatest commandment of the law?" And Jesus replied, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is like it is, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." That is, unselfishly seek the best or higher good for others. The whole law and the writings of the prophets depend on these commandments. I don't want to run all that way and find out when I get before God and goes, "Yeah, you did this, and did, but you didn't love me." He didn't love others. So, it'll be a sad time. Let's keep going. We're going to talk about mercy. Grace is when God gives us good things that we don't deserve. Mercy is when He spares us from the bad things that we do deserve. Blessings are when He is generous with both. God is good all the time.
Amen.
All the time.
God is good.
Amen. So watch this. God wants us to manifest His mercy in our lives. How many in here are absolutely perfect? You don't need grace. You don't need mercy. You're absolutely perfect. Man, hands are not going up. None of us can live without grace. None of us can live without mercy. But so many times, we sense and we don't give the grace that others need or the mercy that others need. So when we consider the mercy of God, we're reminded of something He loved, and His grace toward us, and His mercy is a continuous flow. Y'all say this to me. Continuous flow. When He was pierced on Calvary, and the blood came out of Him, a continuous flow began to come before us all. A continuous flow of forgiveness, a continual flow of compassion, and it's that mercy that God has called all of us, not just the preacher, not just whoever. God calls us all to show it. This mercy and compassion. But God is so rich in His mercy and loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, He gave us life when He raised Christ from the dead. Let's just look at it a little bit further. Ready? New King James Version. But God, who is rich in mercy because of His great love, with which He loved us, when we were dead in trespasses, we were gone. Y'all say we were gone.
We were gone.
He made us alive together with Christ. By grace,
have been saved. That's our goal. But God, so rich is he in his mercy. Because of it, the Lord has satisfied the great and wonderful and intense love with which he has loved us. Don't think about it. The great, wonderful, intense love he has for each of us. Even we were dead, slain by our own shortcomings and trespasses, he made us alive together in fellowship and in union with Christ. He gave us the very life of Christ himself, that same new life in which he quickened him, for it is by grace, his favor and mercy, which you do not deserve, that you were saved, but ever from judgment, and made partakers of Christ's salvation. Let's get ready to dig on down here. Y'all say, go ahead and lower the plow, Pastor.
Lower the plow, Pastor.
Get ready. He didn't say, he said to do justice. He didn't say to show mercy. He said love mercy. That's powerful. Not show mercy, although that's part of it. He said love mercy. So here we go. Let's take this a little deeper here. If we're going to love mercy, first it's going to require us to let go of our pride. Ding, 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 ding. Let go of our pride and let go of our desire for revenge. That's hard. If this ain't hard for you, a gesture of halo. That can be hard sometimes. When my pride has been stomped on, and when I know I've got all right to get back, God says, love mercy. Love mercy. It's going to get, y'all settle it down the plow, so here it comes. We get ready to go deeper. Love mercy means to desire to reach out. Not just let go of your pride, not just let go of that urge to get revenge. It means love mercy, desire, reach out, have it in you. Reach out with God's love. And show them what it's all about. It requires us to forgive, even when it hurts. The Bible says one of the attributes of God, 1 John 4:16, says, God is what?
Love.
He's love. Didn't say he loves, it said he is love. He's the essence of love. He shows us his attribute. And the Bible says he so loved the world that he gave his son. Knowing there were demons, he set him up to be crucified. He set him up. And now he requires us to forgive even when it hurts. But when we choose to extend mercy, we're reflecting God. Wow. We're showing God. When we show mercy, we are choosing to love as he loves. And to forgive as he forgives. That doesn't mean if somebody committed a crime against you and whatever, then they still have to go to court and pick the crime. I'm not talking about that. Because if you do the crime, then you're going to pull the time. I'm not talking about that. What I'm saying is that there was a man on a bus up in New York. He was trying to reach these gangs. And what Daniel Booker said was another guy. He was trying to reach these gangs. And he was on a bus trying to get to them, city bus. And the guys in the gang beat him almost to his death. They captured the guys. This guy's in the hospital. When it comes time for these guys to go to the court, this man had gotten out of the hospital and he was in the courtroom. And when he sentenced all the guys, he raised his hand and said, "Can I say something, Judge?" And the judge says, "Okay, go ahead." He said, "If you'll let me, I'll pull their time." True story. And the judge said, "You're not going to pull their time. They have to pull it." When he said that, their family members were in there. Here he was trying to get his little mission off the ground and couldn't get in, couldn't get it going. So after he offered to pull their time, he goes back to that little mission. And the next service, this guy's family, these guys, their families, were in his church. And with the help of these families, the church began to grow. And he ministered to the guys while they were in prison. And when they got out of prison, they also began to come to this church. And it was amazing how this church began to flourish. And it all started with one man willing to show mercy to a group of guys that tried to kill him. You never know when you show mercy what it's going to do. So how do we do this? How do we manifest mercy in our lives? How do we reflect God? It's not about me. It's about God. It's not about you. It's about God. How do we show others this mercy? How do we show them what God has shown us? Again, grace is when you get good things you don't deserve. Mercy is when you're spared from the bad things you do deserve. God is generous to both of them. I'm going to keep putting that out there. I have to keep that in our minds. Anytime we begin to think that we never do that, maybe not, but there is things you have done. "Well, I would never do such and such. I would never get caught up in that." Hey, maybe not, but I promise you, there's no perfect one in this place. Remember telling about the God was gracious and said, "Oh, but one perfect man on this earth." And that was Jesus. And this guy on the back kept raising his hand, So the priest said, "Please talk to me." He said, "I want to tell you I beg the difference with you." He said, "Beg the difference with me?" He said, "Yes." He said, "There wasn't one perfect man." That was Jesus. And the guy said, "No, there was two." He said, "But who was the first one?" "The first one was Jesus. Who's the other one, praise hell?" He said, "My wife's first husband." How do we show this person? Number one, we got to understand what mercy is. You ready? Mercy is not just forgiveness, but it's also about compassion. It's about seeing the needs of others and responding with kindness and understanding. Again, that doesn't mean it's a get out of jail free card for folks and nothing to do. Somebody does that crime, they're going to do the time. I'm talking about our attitudes toward them. With Bethany, I tried hard her whole life, but especially at the end. I told Bethany, I said, "Bethany, I don't want you going out of here harboring resentment to your dad, your stepdad, excuse me, your father, I'm her dad, her father, her stepfather, and her mother." Then I was her mom and dad. She said, "You're my dad, then my mom. Y'all. I said, "I'm talking about these three people." I said, "It's so important. Yes, it took all those years to get your face rebuilt. Yes, it took all those years, another year to get your nose rebuilt. And yes, all this time it's caused trouble after trouble after trouble. And it seems like most of them got all kind of real easy." I said, "I know, Dad, that I can reach me." I said, "I know." I said, "All but one wound up life in prison. The other two, nope.
I said, Bethany, we have to let Caesar take care of that. But you can't go out of here. Without showing grace and mercy. He says, I think I have, Dad. Can you go? And I said, Bethany, let me tell you, when I'm helping you, I'm helping me because I have part-time medicine. And so together, we forgave them all. And said, God, they're in your hands. Caesar, they're in your hands. But as far as us, we're going to forgive him. And we're going to trust you to take care of this. It's about putting ourselves in others' shoes. Treating them, I don't want to be treated. That's loving mercy. Look, Ephesians 2:4-5 says, but hearing this again, but because of his great love for us, God in his grace and mercy made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions, it is by grace that you have been saved. Number one, you got to understand what it is, and you got to put aside that feeling of repentance and all that. So first, understand mercy is. Second, let's remember that mercy is a choice. A choice. I can't make you show mercy. God's not going to make you show mercy. Satan can't stop you from showing mercy. The only thing that'll stop you from showing mercy is you. We have that choice to make. So, if it could be showing mercy, what's this? There's a problem with that. You ever had a problem showing mercy? I have. I thought I'm not perfect. But then I saw that video of when Bethany was 2 years old and her stepdad had beat her up and molested her. And I saw that bloody body that she had, all those bruises and her teeth chipped and man's handprint on her face. I got so mad, the social worker said, are you all right? I said, I'll be right back. I went to the bathroom and I looked in the mirror and I said, all right, crazy, get it together. I was so hot and tears. And I walked back out and she said, okay, would you go to visit him in the prison and pray for him? And I said, please let me. Just put me in there with him, though. And I'll lay hands on him. And she said, I don't think you're ready for him. We're all human. The problem with showing mercy is a choice. What's this? Mercy doesn't come natural. Not God's mercy. It does not come natural. It's something that you must consciously choose. You have to consciously extend God's mercy. You have to think about it this way. I'm God's representative. I'm God's representative on earth. When I'm walking, he's walking in my shoes, and he wants me to walk in his shoes. He wants me to be his hand extended. Every day we're faced with opportunities to show mercy. Whether it's just forgiving somebody that hurts you, or whether it's just showing kindness to someone in need, we have the choice to show mercy. James chapter 2, verse 13 says, for judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown them mercy. Woo! What does that mean? But the same hand you deal that is the same hand you're going to give. Too many of us walk around with the judge and the jury. There's two kinds of judgments in the Bible. One God tells us to do. That judgment is discerned. You discern, you tell the fruit of it, you tell the tree by the fruit it bears. You can discern people. That's one judgment. We're to do that one. But the judgment that crucifies them has them on the tree. God said, that's my business, not yours. So that kind of judgment, no. He said for judgment without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. Woo, there's judgment coming. If you can't show it, I promise you, whatever how you show it is not coming back to you. Well, you don't know what they did to me. No, I don't, but God does. And God still wants this. The judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. When I stand before God, I want to hear him say, good, well done, my good and faithful servant. Not, so you were judge and jury. Welcome to the big judge. And I'm the jury. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Now, let's go ahead, go to 3. I know this is tough, but we're realigning our vision. We're getting things back in order. This is a little tough, but it's coming up shortly. It's going to get lighter, I promise you. Right now, we're realigning our vision. We're getting back, we're getting our pages correct. Third, we must recognize mercy as a reflection of God's character. When we say mercy, we're reflecting the heart of God. Get ready. When you show mercy, you show the world what God is like. Wow. I'm going to sink in. This is a great responsibility, but it's also a great privilege. When people see you reaching out, I've had them tell me, when you reached out to me, and I've just been mean to you, and I've been bad to you, and you reached out to me. Then I told this over, there was this guy I found who hated my boss. Hated me. And when my boss quit, he was the vice president of engineering. When he quit, he came to his, not the vice president job, but one of the jobs that he did. I sent $9,000, he gave it to me. And also I was second manager. And I remember this guy, after he used to cuss, the other guy started cussing me. You know, as a minister, he knew I was trying to treat everybody godly and church of mercy, and he would cuss me every chance he got. He would set me up. And I just keep on showing him mercy. And one day he came to me and he said, instead of calling those names he called, he said, Real. He said, something's going to be real. And I said, what can I do for everybody? He said, they can fire me. I said, why are they going to fire you? He said, look at this. And there's a couple of $1 million books. He had a powder coat. There's a couple of $1 million books that had shabby powder coats on them. They said, if I don't do this kind of work, I can't work in this company. He said, I didn't do that, Bill. I promise I didn't do that. Can you help me? The first time you said that, you read my life inside, bud. You're eager. That's the flesh side. But the mercy side said, do something. And so I went through all the records. And I did it with a fine-tooth comb. And I found out that those boats that he got credit for were the last two boats of the guy that got fired. It took his place. And he was trying to set up this new guy. And I took it to before Mr. Fountain, another guy who said, this guy didn't do this. He didn't do it. I said, it's the guy y'all fired. That's the guy that done this. You leave this guy alone. And so they said, we're glad you showed us that. We're not going to fire him. The next day, he came up to my office and he said, thank you, Real. I said, thank you for what? He said, you saved my job. And from that time on, he never cussed me. He had all the bad words in it, never again. I left to come here. Years later, he retired and he moved beside my father-in-law. My father-in-law was talking to him and said, so you retired? And he said, yeah. He said, where did you store? He said, found fire boats. He said, my son-in-law used to work there. He said, who's your son? He said, David Lynn.
And instead, the guy started crying. Big old Marine started crying. And McConnell said, you know what he did to me? You know, this big guy, I'm not sure if I should have done what I've done, but he's crying. And he said, that's not Jim. I swayed it. He said, you don't understand. He said, are you okay? He said, you don't understand what that man means to me. He said, that was mean to him. And he said, well, he had a chance to let me get fired. He dug down deep. He found a way. It proved that I was the only one. He saved my child. He said, there's nothing I won't do for that boy. Mercy. Mercy. When I had a chance, I chose mercy. I could have turned my back. I could have said easily, bye. But no, I thought at least give him the opportunity to give it. So, lastly, you must realize that mercy is a journey. It's not something that we can just master overnight. It's not something that we grow in and grow over time. It's something that we have to do a little bit at a time and figure this thing out. We just cannot do it once. We got to figure it out, tweak it, and adjust it. Because remember, there's a big difference. A big difference in letting Caesar do what Caesar's going to do. And let's show him mercy. So, as we continue to walk with God, we have to let his word shape us, and we have to become more and more merciful. Let me go back to mercy again and get ready to close. Granted, here's the place that I'm walking up. Show mercy. You never know what storm they may be walking through. Wow. Sometimes we get so caught up in our own storm, then we get other people are going through things too. We get so caught up in what we're dealing with, then we get what other people are dealing with. Biblical mercy. Let's just trek through this one more time. The term mercy is often used to describe God's character. His mercy requires steadfast love, his willingness to forgive, and his commitment to act on behalf of his people. How many times, look, if I was God, I don't know about y'all, but every time I got an order, say, God, I'm going to do it again. If I was God, you know, not, especially the times I'm going to do it again, God, I promise. And a week or two later, goes, I told you I weren't going to let me inside one more time. And then here goes again. Well, Lord, I really promise I need your help. Because I'm going to give you some help right now. But instead, he reaches down with love. Because mercy is to withhold deserved retribution. Deserved retribution. But God calls us to love mercy. Again, that word love is to desire, to seek, to hold close. When you love your spouse, when you love your children, when you love a co-worker, there's a whole lot different than you work with somebody you don't know. Also, there's a whole lot different working with somebody that's really hard to get along with. When you're working with your spouse, with your children, that kind of love, so easy. Show mercy. Give them a one up to help them out. God says, watch when I do that with everybody. Wow. When God calls us to mercy, he's essentially calling us to be like him. Amen? He wants us to be like him. You want to see this church fill up? Fill up the word we got to deal with. I'm telling you, if we'll follow these three things, we did one last week, one this week, another one next week. We'll do those three things. This church will fill up. That's not my promise. John 3:16, for God so loved
the world. He's so desired and sought after and held us close that he gave his only begotten Son to die in our place. Here it goes. We're closing. Mercy in our lives is not just about our actions, but it's about our hearts. It's about allowing God's mercy to transform us from the inside out. As we do this, God will not only experience the joy of God's forgiveness, we won't just experience it. We will become channels of his mercy, channels of his grace. This week, we need to strive to manifest mercy in our lives, not by our own strength, but by the grace of God. I remember one of the first guys, years ago, my very first pastor, I remember a guy that showed me mercy and showed me how to live it out as I watched him do it on show other people. Y'all know him. Some of you lived your spend it. Man, did he show me some stuff. When I was ready to call in, he'd go, "Glory!" Show mercy. And I remember all those years I worked with him and showing mercy. He got Alzheimer's. He was in a nursing home in Grantsburg. And I was in there singing to the people in the break room, and they had him locked in the Alzheimer's unit. But they let him come out as we were singing, and he sat right in front of me and blessed his heart. Some of the songs we had sang all those years, he couldn't remember the words. And he kept looking. The whole time I was paying, he kept looking in this refrigerator inside me, clear glass refrigerator. And finally, he looked at me in the leader's classic way. He said, "Hey, Bud." I said, "Yes, sir." He says, "My credit's been here." And I said, "What you need, bro?" He said, "I'd like to get one of those Pepsis." And I said, "Son, sir, your credit is always good to me." And we were sitting there, got a drink and put a dollar in there. And he said, "Thanks, man." I'm not even sure he even knew who I was. But that didn't matter because I knew who he was. I remember the mercy he had showed so many people. Hiring people that nobody else would hire. Putting up with things that nobody else would put up with. I remember it. That mercy. Instead of judging or retribution this week, try mercy in all of our relationships, especially close ones. And watch this week be a turnaround in your life. I mean a turnaround. In your life, in your relationships. Everybody be standing. God is so good to us. God has done so much for us. But the biggest thing he's done for me is show me his grace and show me his mercy. I do my best to show his grace.
If you're here today, number one,
us and better for God. I need God to strengthen me, to show me His grace and mercy in a powerful way right now, because I'll be honest with you, Pastor, I've been blown a lot lately. I really need it. If I look around, every eye closed. If I'm talking to you, put that hand up. Put that hand up and say, I really need it this week, God. I need it. Bless the Lord. Bless Him. Show us strong in your lives, God. Maybe you're here today and you and God got it going on, but you don't always think about you or walking in His shoes and Him walking in your shoes. You don't always think about it being His hand extended. Then I stopped. We go to the doctor last Thursday. I had to go to the doctor. We come back by and we stop to get something to eat. The waitress come to us. And she told us, of course, that she was going to the ECU and that she was going to go to elementary ed. And there was something special about her. Man, there was something special about her. And we looked at her and told her, you realize when you're teaching all these little ones, you're God's hand extended. And she stopped. Thank you. And I took off one of those great Bethany bracelets and I put it on her arm. She said, I can't take that. I said, yeah, you can. And she put it on there. And I said, God's got you. Drew His hand extended. And she said, you're going to make me cry right here. And she said, thank you. Thank you. I tell people all the time when I see them working, walking, mercy, grace, you're God's hand extended. Keep it going. Keep showing it. People need to see it, especially this last day when everybody's out for themselves and there's so much stuff going crazy. Show them love. Show them mercy. Show them grace. Hold us all pray together right now as we're going to close. Lord, we thank you.
We thank you.
For your grace.
For your grace.
And for your mercy.
And for your mercy.
Because of that, we are here today.
We're here today.
We thank you, God.
We thank you, God.
That we haven't
been
consumed. We ask you right now.
We ask you right now
to help us.
Help us
to be your hand.
To be your hand
extended.
To be a channel.
Be a channel
of your love.
Your love. Of your grace.
Of your grace.
Of your mercy.
Of your mercy.
Help us.
Help us.
Treat others.
Treat others
as we would like us to be treated.
Yeah.
We thank you for it, God.
We thank you for it.
Help us, Lord, not just show mercy.
Help us.
Help us to love mercy.
Love mercy.
In the name of Jesus. We thank you for it all.
Thank you for it all.
Now we're going to say the Lord's Prayer. And after we say the Lord's Prayer, we're going to make a dismissal soon prayer. Ready? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us
not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory
forever.
Father God, it's a privilege and honor to be able to stand up this morning and say we thank you for your mercy and your grace, Lord. Party house today, Lord, we share the mercy and grace of those that you have seen now. Let us reach out like you did to us, Father, and show them the love we have for you, that you have to us, Father. Father, be with us now, to save and bring us back up next time. We'll be careful to give you all the praise, the glory, the honor. It's in your Son's name that we ask you. And for this I do say, amen. Amen.
I was going to ask Brandon if he'd go
hang around.